Welcome back to our 40-day plan. I'm Elizabeth Mahusai, the women's minister here at Cottonwood Creek Church, and I am looking forward to chatting with you about praying and obeying. So I titled this lesson, The Catalyst to Prayer in the Equation of Life. You see, in my days of teaching chemistry, words like catalyst and equation and even equilibrium were things that I very commonly taught. Well, I'm not going to give you a science lesson, so I just want you to be at ease, but I do want to use the concept to really look at the idea and the principle behind praying and obeying. You see, prayer acts as a catalyst in the equation of our life, and a life lived in equilibrium, specifically as it relates to obeying and abiding. Now, so that you understand the concept behind equilibrium, I thought I would pull an example of something that we have experienced real time recently, and that is the idea of supply and demand. You see, in the spring, we saw that for the most part, leading up to February, the supply and demand of toilet paper was in equilibrium. The supply was good relating to the demand. The demand and the supply were somewhat equal, so they were in equilibrium. And then rumors of COVID and people started going out and buying toilet paper, and we saw a disruption of the equilibrium in that the toilet paper was flying off the shelves, so the demand was high and the supply could not catch up. And as a result, we were left with shelves of empty paper products, and people were literally counting how many rolls of toilet paper they actually had left. I certainly hope that we do not revisit that, but it does help us to understand the concept of equilibrium, supply and demand. And what I want us to look at today is how in our prayer life, we need an equilibrium between obeying and abiding. And specifically, when you think about obeying and abiding, I want you to think of prayer being right smack in the middle of that. You see, in that location, prayer in a science world would be the catalyst. It's something that is used to make an equation go, but itself is not consumed. You see, we can pray, and prayer is what allows us to experience this equilibrium in life between obeying and abiding. So let's look further at that. I have 3 points that I want you to consider as we cultivate an equilibrium in our life of prayer. The first is that we need to pray for God to reveal your heart. I need to pray for God to reveal my heart. I'm encouraging you to pray for God to reveal your heart. You know, in Jeremiah 17:9, it says, the heart is deceitful above all things and beyond cure. Who can understand it? I, the Lord, search the heart and examine the mind to reward a man according to his conduct, according to what his deeds deserve. You see, God is an accurate judge of the heart. And we need to pray for God to reveal our heart so that we better understand our motives, because He will help us to uncover that. It also says in Psalm 139, 23 and 24 that we're asking God, the psalmist is asking God, search me, O God, and know my heart. Test me and know my anxious thoughts. See if there is any offensive way in me and lead me in the way everlasting. You see, God knows the deceit of our heart, and He can reveal that. God also understands the anxiety and the anxious thoughts that would plague our mind and could easily take us off course in accomplishing that which He has for us to do. So then we pray and for God to reveal us through searching our hearts and our minds. And finally, if God can create the universe, He can create a clean heart in us. You know, Psalm 51:10, it's one of my favorites. It says, create in me, O God, a clean heart and renew a steadfast spirit within me. When we ask God to reveal our heart, And we begin to be aware of that which he brings to the surface. Then we ask God to create in us a clean heart and to renew a steadfast spirit within us. Well, the second thing I want to look at is that we need to not only pray for God to reveal our heart, we want to pray for the Holy Spirit to reveal temptations that we are going to face. In John 16, 7 through 8, Jesus is saying, I will send him to you, that being the Holy Spirit. When he comes, he will convict the world of guilt in regard to sin and righteousness and judgment. So we need the Holy Spirit to make us aware of the sin that is in our lives. And the more we're aware of the sin that is in our lives, the more we can be attuned to the temptations that would lead us into more sin. You see, our challenge is that we believe, not gonna happen to me. We'll look at other people, we'll judge them for the choices that they're making, especially in relation to sin, especially if it's a sin that we're not challenged with, and we'll go, no, that's not me, not gonna happen to me. But what we need is 1 Corinthians 10, 11 through 13 that says, so if you think you're standing firm, be careful that you don't fall. Because no temptation has overtaken you except that which is common to mankind. And God is faithful that he will not let you be tempted beyond what you can bear. Because when you're tempted, he's going to provide you a way of escape. Here's the thing. We have to first acknowledge that we are just as likely as the next person to fall into a pit of sin because we were not looking for the temptation that would overtake us. Listen, we've got to be on alert. We need to be prayerful. That's why we have 1 Peter 5:8 that says, be alert and sober-minded. Your enemy, the devil, prowls around like a roaring lion seeking whom he may devour. You and I must acknowledge the fact that our enemy wants to take us down. He wants to defile everything that God has put into place. He wants to take us off course. He wants us to be caught in that pit of sin. He wants to blind our eyes to the temptations that are before us. This is why we need to be praying for God to reveal our heart and for the Holy Spirit to reveal our temptations so that we are prepared to take the way out that God has so graciously and faithfully provided. The third aspect is to pray with hopeful expectancy as you obey his commands. Listen, what God has in Scripture, it is not always easy to obey. I mean, if you're there, I want you to think about how often you're like, oh, that's so easy. And there might be some things that are easy for you, but there are a lot of things that God makes very clear that it's not so easy to obey. Here is the key. As we're obeying, if we'll pray with hopeful expectancy, it's amazing how we'll be able to take the next step and the next step and the next step. I want to focus on 1 John 3, 21 through 24 as we unpack this idea of hopeful expectancy. It says, dear friends, if our hearts do not condemn us, we have confidence before God. Okay, let me just pause right there and say something that we need to be able to say to ourselves regularly is God knows my heart. God knows your heart and he knows my heart. I mean, we established that when I said pray for God to reveal your heart. He is the rightful judge of what is going on in our heart. He can reveal that through the Holy Spirit. So we need to understand that God knows our heart. And then he goes on to say in verse 22, and receive from him anything we ask because we keep his commands and we do what pleases him. And then in 23, and this is his command. All right. So we're going to keep his commands. We're going to receive what we ask because we believe in the name of his son, Jesus Christ, and we're to love one another as he commanded us. And then verse 24, the one who keeps God's commands lives in him and he in them. And this is how we know that he lives in us. We know it by the Spirit that he gave us. Now, I want you to think for a moment about this concept in 1 John 3, where it says that we are to obey his commands and do what pleases him. And I thought as I was, you know, preparing in my science-mindedness, that this equation of life, what would it look like? Well, this graphic shows you an example of what the equation of life might look like. You believe, so we're on the reactant side, that left side, you believe, and in 1 John, he's very clear, you're to believe in the name of his son, Jesus Christ. And we are to do that which we have been commanded, which is to love one another. So when you add belief and love for one another, and you're using prayer as the catalyst, we can expect the products of receiving what you ask. Because God has searched your heart. God has revealed the temptations. God is purifying your motives. And so you're going to be asking for that which is in alignment with his will. And so when we take believing and we take loving one another in our prayer life, we can expect to receive that for which we ask, because that for which we ask will be in alignment with what God has given us in his word. And you know what? When you're living that way, when you're asking rightly based on God's word, and you're having hopeful expectancy, that empowers obedience. It empowers obedience. Sometimes we think that, I don't know if I can do that. I don't know if I can continue to be faithful. Listen, have hopeful expectation in your prayer life that God will be all that he has said he will be, that God will do all that he says that he will do. Hopeful expectancy. You see, the key to a catalyst in aiding an equation is that it is not being used up. You see, prayer as your catalyst is a resource available to you, and you will never be able to use it up. This is why we are always encouraged to pray without ceasing. 1 Thessalonians 5, it says to pray without ceasing. That's in verse 17. But can I say this to you? You can't outpray God's willingness to answer. I'm going to say it again. You can't outpray God's willingness to answer. And when you've allowed him to search your heart and to reveal it, when you've yielded to the Holy Spirit revealing the temptation so that you can be sober and alert and on guard, and when you are praying with hopeful expectancy as you choose daily to obey God's commands, then you can experience the equilibrium in the equation of life of obeying and abiding. You see, as you obey, you're going to desire to abide. And the more you're abiding in Christ, the more you're going to desire obey, to have obedience. And prayer is the conduit through which both of those things remain in equilibrium with each other. Listen, today, I want to encourage you. May my obedience yield more abiding. And may our abiding yield more obedience. And may we remember that prayer is the catalyst that helps to produce the equilibrium in the equation of our life. Heavenly Father, thank you so much for the truth of your word, for the value of prayer in our life. I pray that you would continue to grow us, Lord, in this area, that we would rebuild our lives around prayer that is in alignment with God's word, that edifies and honors you, Lord, and exemplifies you to a world who is in desperate need of men and women who have vibrant prayer lives, who are obeying and abiding, trusting you in the process. And I pray these things in Christ's name. Amen.